That's Leanne and that's Jenny. And we started working with it. And the idea for the palette is that you have the warm colors on one side,
okay,
and the cool colors on the other side. And you generally have your lightest color and your darkest color opposite. So I would have my white here and my black here. And I would have from white to Naples yellow, to ochre, to reds, and to browns and purples, slowly going to greens and blues and into black.
Okay? Interesting blue.
That's a turquoise blue, that's a gorgeous blue, which we see a lot in the skin.
Yeah.
So you see how that's the two are separated. So if I took the wrong color accidentally, but I wanted red, I'm in the red family already. So I'm not thinking like, well, I want red, but there's blue there, right? They're always kind of separate. And I'm not gonna confuse my white and my black. It's always separate. You can see on my larger palette, it's the same idea in a slightly different order. We start here from the white, and we go to the ochres, into the reds, and if we want it round to purples, black is here, blues, greens. But the idea is that we have separated the colors, right? So this is very traditional. I'm going to add some now. We're doing a Rembrandt. I discovered this dioxide purple, and this is the heatiest color on its own, but when you mix it with other colors, it makes amazing flesh tones. So we're gonna add it a little bit here because we used it already.
And that is that.
Very little. You need very little oil paint to paint, and that's what people don't realize it. So
love that.
You can see that this says series one.
Okay.
That's the cheapest because there's very little pigment. The pigment is not expensive. It's basically from Earth. If it says series four, that's when you're paying $50-$70 a tube.
Okay.
That means that that pigment is extremely expensive, rare, and there's not enough. There's very little binder. It's pure pigment. No, it's cheapo.
Oh.
This red is very expensive.
Red is that cadmium?
Yes, cadmium red. The reason you want to buy an expensive pigment rather than a cheap one, if you buy the cheap one, you'll need a lot to paint, and it's never red enough. If you use expensive, you use a dab, and it'll last you the entire painting.
Okay.
So it's actually cheaper to buy the more expensive, and the quality of your painting will be incredible. I always put some more white. White is always something we need. I like my thick white, so this is titanium white. The zinc white is more translucent, which I don't like. Doesn't give you the body. Okay, let's put a little ochre. And a little red. This is the series four.
Mm-hmm.
So cadmium red medium. It's kind of a deep, beautiful red.
Beautiful.
And this will last. Oof, you could paint an entire background for this and it will last.
Okay.
And the color I can't live without, this is alizarin crimson. It's the color of your shirt. This is 90% of my painting. I just love this color, so I'll put more of it. This mixes to everything, to the cools, to the warms. It's just gorgeous. Then we'll use a little bit of my favorite, the only brown I like. It's called Van Dyke Brown. And this is the Rembrandt brand is the best brand. This is a brown here. That's of course an artist, a Baroque artist. And he's so good with his browns. They call the name after him. There's a Rubens red too.
Oh yeah?
Yeah. And so there'll be a Leanne. What color is your favorite?
Navy blue.
Leanne, and this color is what I use instead of black. This is a Prussian blue.
Yes.
And I mix
it.
I mix it with alizarin crimson. When you mix those two together, you get a beautiful velvety black.
Okay. Because this has sort of like green in it, doesn't it?
It's like almost like ultramarine.
Yeah, yeah.
But when you add that alizarin crimson, it turns into the deep velvety black, warm black, just gorgeous. So I almost never use actually black. And we'll need a little turquoise blue.
I love that turquoise.
That's not so much in this little Rembrandt demo, but in your daughter's skin and your skin, that's going to be a lot. We'll see, we can use that. And green, not so much.
Green is the same.
This is a beautiful green, which I don't remember the name because it got so dark, but I just love it. Oh, yeah. We'll find it. I think I have another tube. I do love this. It's great for skin tones. So you know how a lot of students, they come and they say, how do I mix a skin tone? Which is completely the wrong question because there is no skin tone. Skin has almost every color depending what's reflecting in it. So this is skin tone.
Okay.
There's no, it's not like that horrible peach that beginners use. Okay, so we're gonna avoid that.
Okay.
And then
good to know.
Yeah. Yeah, you don't start, okay, I'm gonna make like a Barbie color, right? Okay, you can see in the Rembrandt there's
lots of colors.
Lots and lots and lots and lots of colors.
Yeah.
Right? Woven. And then Van Gogh will blow it up and make it even more obvious, but it's in here. And I always have my rag in my hand because you're going to need to blot your brushes to make sure you don't have too much color, too much turpentine. So you always have a brush in one hand and a rag in the other hand. It's impossible to paint without the rag. And we need a little bit of oil.
What do you use? Linseed oil?
I use poppy seed.
Oh,
this is amazing. This can last me all of this huge canvases.
Wow.
2-3 drops of this will last the entire painting.
That's incredible.
It is non-toxic. It doesn't smell at all. It smells nice.
Yeah, that's
beautiful. Doesn't make you feel dizzy or anything. So I'm gonna.
That's amazing. So it's poppy seed oil.
Poppy seed oil. I'm gonna. I'm gonna pour it in the middle. Just look at how thick it is, that it just sits there beautifully, just beautifully. I'm gonna use one of these and pour it in here, just a couple of drops, so that it's contained and I can dip and find it. But that's all I need for the entire painting.
Amazing.
It gives you a lush, beautiful sensation to you. You'll feel that the paint drags differently. And then, of course, we need our turpentine, and that's the stinky part.
Yeah.
I use the odorless one, which poisons you without odor.
So you go down to
you're oblivious. So there's that. Yeah.
That is such a good time.
A large ventilated space, we don't have to worry about it. And then brushes.
Yeah.
Brushes should be, for me, long and flat. Okay. The tendency of paint is to clog the root of the brush. So if you have a short brush, its life is going to be very short because its flexibility is here.
Right?
So if it's short and it's clogged, it becomes like this dead brush. And I like them flat because I can make beautiful lines, I can make all kinds of, I can even make tips. This is what really works for me well. Again, it should have a nice flat edge, flexibility. If it looks like this.
I actually have some oil brushes that I need to find.
This is what I wouldn't be able to use anymore. Try to bend it. You see, it doesn't have, and try to bend this. That's flexibility. This has no flexibility, and the end is frayed.
Yeah.
So why would I ever use, there's no such thing as a bad brush. It can do different things. If I wanted to make like little dots that are spread, like little stipples, I could use it for this effect. So I use my quote bad brushes in a different jar.
Okay.
So I can grab them for various effects and my really good flexible brushes in a different jar with which I mostly will paint.
Okay.
That's the trick. And then I like cheap brushes because I don't want to worry about them. Good. All right. So we're going to paint. I'm going to try to paint this.
You've got Doug Shearer and Alan Katz watching.
Oh, okay. Hi. Okay. So we're going to start by actually drawing with paint. I just dip into the turpentine my brush And immediately I wiped off the excess. You see how I wiped it off on there? And I'm going to start maybe with my alizarin crimson to draw. And look how I draw, I drag the paint, look at the palette. I just drag the paint out into the middle. You see how I dragged it out?
Yeah.
And I'm going to use not that, but the part that I dragged out, right? And I'm going to first just draw that this is where the eyebrow is, right? Mm-hmm. And this is going to be where the eye is. Now you know all of this mm-hmm. from us studying together, mm-hmm. drawing very lightly. And this is the shape. Approximately. It doesn't have to be precise. I just want to know where the paint will go. This is the area I'm going to paint. This is the beginning of the nose here.
Right.
The wrinkle is going to be coming in handy for the expression. And there's that core shadow we talked about that's mm-hmm. over here. And I don't even need to do much, but this is where the iris right. and the pupil will be. Just so I know. I do that loosely and quickly. And it's going to sit there. It's not going to disappear no matter what I do. So now I'm going to create a kind of a, with my thicker brush, I'm going to mix a middle tone. So there's some ochres, some alizarin crimson, maybe some green into it. And I mix it in the middle, I kind of drag and mix. That's too green.
Yeah.
I'll tone it down with a little red, which immediately turns it a little brownish. You see?
Yeah.
And I'm trying to mix this kind of a color middle tone. That's too dark. So I can add like this very quickly. But I do want it rather dark at first. And very quickly I'm just going to lay in just some of the dark tones. Just again roughly. And then here, you see, even with a thick brush, I can get in there. I don't care about the details yet at all. Nothing is going anywhere, nothing's disappearing. I'm not worried about it. That red is going to stay underneath to guide me. Now, this brush is getting too large, so I'm going to switch. I always wipe off my brushes to keep the tip clean, right? Otherwise, it's going to get ruined. Let's take a little bit wider brush, I mean smaller brush than the other one. I go into my turpentine, I wipe it off. I take more color.
Now you're highlighting a little bit.
Now I'm going to, not so much, yeah, maybe highlighting, but also just getting into smaller areas because the other brush wasn't allowing me. Yeah, maybe let's go a little lighter just here for a second. But also I notice how dark the white of the eye is.
Right.
So I'm going to make it dark in there. I'm going to come back and bring some of my alizarin crimson with a little bit of that blue. Remember we talked about that blue?
Mm-hmm.
I'll mix them together. Look, if I mix them, it mixes into this beautiful, beautiful color. Mm-hmm. And I can draw with it. I can start drawing a little darker parts so I don't get completely lost. I know that the pupil is in the middle. I'm just gonna identify it so it starts looking like an eye a little bit. And now I can actually even think about shadows, right? Lightly. So I'm going to do all of this big, large chunk of a shadow. You see that? Mm-hmm. And underneath here. And remember the bag
mm-hmm.
that we worked? That's the whole eyeball that I'm trying to feel. And I'm going to say that's where the eyebrow is. And this shadow into the nose. Right?
Yeah.
Very little is needed to actually start looking like an eye. Right?
Absolutely.
Okay, so this is too light over here. I need to get rid of all of this lightness. You see how dark it is? In order for me to bring those beautiful reflections, I need to go darker here. And what color would you say is his irises?
Like a hazily color.
Hazily, a little bit greenish, right?
Yeah.
So I'm going to take a smaller brush now and make that hazel color. I'm going to take some of that turquoise blue, believe it or not, and some of that Van Dyke brown and mix it together. And it will make a nice hazely color and make it nice and dark. In the middle, it's darkest. So I'm gonna take a little bit more of that blue, mix it with Van Dyke brown. And let's see, I think I got some other paint that I don't want in there. So I'll clean up a little. And even a little bit of that purple. I just dip it into my turpentine and wipe.
I see what you're saying.
Okay, I want the pupil now darker in there. Right? And now, I want to paint all of that inner part of the eye, the top lid and the inside rim. So I'm going to again clean my brush, always clean my brush, wipe it off. And I'm never going to use this dark brush for highlights. I'm going to separate my brushes. So a separate brush will be for my highlights. Let's take a good brush. And now, first we're going to see, all that red in there? So now we're going to start with just red. And I'm going to mix the bright red, remember that expensive red, with a little bit of alizarin crimson again. I mix almost alizarin crimson every time, every color. So it's not so brilliant. Okay.
Yeah.
And now I'm going to, with the flatness of the brush, I'm going to just draw. And it's going to look a little cartoony at first, because I'm going to tone it down later. Remember, it turns, right? Yeah, it turns into the eye, and the corner I know is going to be red, and I'm going to fix all that in a moment. You start by exaggeration.
Aren't I lucky that I'm learning this?
Okay, and in the eye, do you see in the iris, there's a blacker part here, darker part on the outside, but not all around?
Exactly.
So I'm going to add that right now. That's important. I'm going to add that. Because it's going to make that hazel in the middle look more translucent.
Definitely.
By comparison.
I mean, from here already.
And then we need to bring in some light and lift the bottom lid above, higher now. So now I need my light brush, Let's do that. This is the fun part, Liam. Watch this. Into that red. So I'm putting light into the, like the Naples yellow, that color, into the red that already exists. Flatly, softly. And it mixes automatically in my painting. Do you see this?
It's beautiful.
Because there's red underneath it.
Right.
So I'm going into the red, right? And right here, it's a little harsher, so I need to make that a little harsher. A little bit more red and more crisp. Do you see that? Right in there. Right there. You see it? And right in here on the inside, right? Because we have a dimension.
That's right.
Right? So I'm painting that dimension. You see that?
Yeah.
Of the
just
lid.
In the lid.
Do you see that?
Yeah.
And here it just feels red.
Yeah.
Okay, now I'm going to put some fun highlights. I would wait longer in general, but just so that I don't take all day doing this.
So how long would you wait?
I would, okay, we can wait. Let's see, I just wanted to show you an effect. Okay, let's take some ochre and red. It makes it kind of an orangey now. See those neighbors? So pull the paint out and do it in the middle.
Yeah.
Like that. That we can layer now flatly here. You see that?
Yeah.
Flat, because that's like a plane, right? And that plane repeats here. And that repeats here, maybe a little bit lighter.
Yeah.
There's a rhyme to it, right? And we can make it look darker by putting something lighter next to it, right?
Not much.
And now side, this is flat side, remember from your drawing, right?
And the light's hitting it.
Mm-hmm. So let's do that. I'm gonna show how to do the eyebrow in a moment. Do you see this?
Yeah.
Slowly. And then in here, I can dab it in here. You see how depth flat? To make it a little bit more dimensional.
Right.
Let's do a little animation with the eye. I can't wait. Just to show you. Now, it's very, very, the highlight here is very dark. Do you see that? But nevertheless, it makes a difference.
It's highlighted, but you can, it's barely noticeable.
Yeah, but I'm going to use ochre here to actually do it. And let's see if I can do it right. Just a little. Just a tiny little bit.
Yeah, I see.
And then here, I'm going to, remember how the light penetrates through?
So it's on the other side of the iris.
It has to come through here. I mixed a little bit of ochre with red. You see this?
Uh-huh.
So yeah. It goes through. And right here, where the highlight is actually the watery part of the eye. So now I have to find a brush that's really flat, really clean.
None of those.
And I have to change my rag. We don't use the dirty rag. Your rag is your tool. I'm gonna wipe my brush, clean my brush, get it to a beautiful edge. And now this is really cool. I dip it into my white flat. Let me do that. A little bit here. And I'm going to paint, not with my brush. I'm going to paint with the paint in between the painting and the brush. So imagine how lightly I have to touch. Can't touch my brush.
Right.
The paint touches and that's when I stop. That's how light it touches. Now, I will come, it's too light. I can start blending it in a little.
And it goes a long way.
Mm-hmm. I want to tone it down slowly. And there's a little on the outside as well glistening, so I'm going to use my Naples yellow so it's not too bright. But it's right here. Do you see the second?
Yeah,
palette?
Underneath, yeah.
Underneath there?
Definitely.
And it's a little closer than what I have, so I'm going to move it. I'm going to take a darker color from underneath and come back and close it, move it upwards. Paint, oil paint just moves so fast. You see that?
Yeah. Yeah, definitely.
Now let's make that iris work a little bit better because it's too fat right now. So look at the white of the eye. This is the color of the white of the eye. Do you see that? You see?
Yeah.
So now I'm going to paint that and correct it a little bit.
Making it a little bit bigger.
More precise. Yeah. A little more mysterious. Now I can come back with a little red.
I like his eye, his new eye.
And what I'm trying to show you is how little changes it a lot.
Mm.
I mean, a millimeter is too generous to say.
Mm.
Less than a millimeter makes a huge difference in the painting. Do you see that?
Yeah.
Let's use a little blue here and green to make this a little harsher. Let's see. And purple. Now right now it's not right. You know why it's not right? Because the top lid has to come over the iris, but right now it looks like the iris is coming over the top lid. So when I did that, now I have to come back with the top lid and close it. And a lot of time you just go back and forth. Because I had to raise my iris, but now I have to close it with the lid.
Just have a little look.
Mm-hmm. You see how that line looks like it's on top of that line? Yeah. That line should be on top. You see how that's on top?
So you're looking to put this.
Yep. So now I have to, and I dip it into my oil, a little bit of my poppy seed oil. Now I really need it to make it gooey and beautiful. And let's see. I need to get it just right. The tip is so important. Because if it's not flat, forget it. And that's too bright.
It's more red.
Now I know you're going to be amazing with color mixing, Liam, so I need a different brush. And this is where you wish that nobody in the world would be watching you right now. Because it's so, you know, it's so private, you know?
Well, there are a few people watching, I have to tell you. They're so lucky.
How's it coming out? A little starting to look, right?
It's beautiful. I think his eye's warmer than the Rembrandt's eye. It's a,
what did he know?
Yeah. It's a gentler eye.
Now, I want to show you that eyebrow. That eyebrow is, look at how he does it. It's all painted. None of it is drawn.
Right.
And it's on, it has to go on top of all the structure that we've painted.
Right.
Right? So I can put on only the eyebrow at the end. I sort of emphasized where it would go, but now I'm actually going to show you how to paint it. So I'm going to take my brown, my ochres. At this point, I have this amazing goo in the middle. That's all of this is useful.
Beautiful.
You know, I don't even know what's in there, but I just, it feels right. And now I have to paint the eyebrow as it grows, right? So I'm going to start here and you kind of make these gestures. And here is actually a brush that's frayed is helpful because you want irregular marks.
And it's interesting that you're still using a flat brush.
Yeah. And I want something that's really not precise. Just where the hair, you see how it's starting to feel like hair?
Definitely.
And now I want to emphasize this darkness. So I'm going to use a little bit of that purple. Now watch what happens when I use that.
Wow.
Hold on. Purple and that alizarin together. Look at this beautiful color, that darkness, and maybe even a little blue.
Yeah.
That. Now that's nice. I want to push that.
Okay.
I want to feel his eyeball underneath, which is not clear here. And remember that the core shadow, right? This is where the core shadow knowledge becomes so useful because we want to turn the eye that way. Do you see how that happens really fast? I can even use my finger, whatever is not right, to smooth the transition. But it still feels right.
Yeah.
You see that? And then in here, I want to draw that wrinkle right into the forehead. The brow is going to be just in a couple of places because of the gravity, dark underneath. You can see a couple of brush strokes here. Like that, right? And it gives it a little expression. And now let's put a little highlight again on the top of the lid. Now I can calibrate and see a few places need a few highlights. Just a little. I'm mixing just simply Naples yellow with ochre. Because so much paint is underneath, the reds are gonna come through. Right here, right? We wanna feel that brow.
Just on the lid.
We want to feel that turn where the light hits it. And again, we want to feel it here, a little reflection. And you know what? It doesn't have to be a perfect copy. I can just feel that this should be a little glistening here. And I just feel like it needs a little light, that it's a little almost sweaty, you know? And here around the nose, where the nose would be, that would be a little kind of like reflection and sweatiness of the face, the breathing. And anything you don't like, it's so easy to wipe off and take off. And then a little Dutch red nose, your nose, right?
Yeah. It
starts here, the redness.
Your body nose.
Right? I don't see it. We're doing just a little detail, but, and then the side. And then look, let's just add, for the hell of it, let's just add some hair just to frame it. I'll show you. You want to transition here. Just do some darkness here. Just kind of frame it. Let's make a little. See how he blurs it?
Yeah.
So let's just pick some goo for the middle of our palette and turn it. It's a little green actually, because there's a little shadow
here.
Yeah,
I see the green in it.
Mm-hmm. You're so good at color. I know you're going to be great with this. Tortured you with all the drawing, and now that's the fun part. You see the green, how that turns it? Right?
Absolutely.
That's so fun. Let's add a little green here. That's what we're missing. If we looked at the original, I bet you would see. You see the green here?
Yeah, definitely.
That's why everybody says, oh, you know, Rembrandts are so brown. It's so not. It has every color when you come up to it. You just have to come closer. You see how that green turns it? And if it's too much, well, we just blend it again. You just go back and forth.
Yeah, I like that.
But that's that core right
here. Yeah, yeah.
That's where I wanted to emphasize it. Let's do this little.
Very beautiful.
Let's just do this fun part. Staring at us, right?
Mm.
And then here, I'm just going to wipe the excess where I didn't paint his, because we don't know what his nose, we don't have that full reproduction, we don't know what the nose looks like, right? Mm. Let's just take that off so we can enjoy the eye. And there it is.
Beautiful.
All right, guys, we're going to continue privately. Let me just take this off and show you what that looks like. And what the palette looks like. And I hope you enjoyed this. Bye.